world of football with a soccer perspective. This is Soccer Today with Duane Rollins and Kevin Laramée, live on the Sports Podcasting Network.
Good day, good night. Welcome to Soccer Today for Friday, September 4th, 2020. I'm Kevin Laramée, joined by Duane Rollins. As always, a Friday morning New York news dump happened this morning at 9:12 a.m. The New York Rebels announced that themselves and Chris Armas mutually agreed to part ways. That's code for he's no longer our coach, and maybe down the road we'll figure out how it all happened. But to talk about this change of regime in New York, joining us, the original soccer writer coming from New York, Michael Lewis of Front Row Soccer, is joining us this morning. Michael, how's your quiet Friday morning so far?
What's happened? Can you tell me what's happened? I'll tell you. It's something that I think we all live for breaking news. We just don't know when it's going to happen. When I say we, I mean all of us in the media business. And I'm putting together a column about the Red Bulls. I needed to do some quick research about the team and go to their website. And like a minute prior, they had put up the story about Chris Armas getting sacked. And I just said, red alert, put the column aside for now. I'll update it later and take care of that. You know, I think we saw it coming. I'm not certain we saw it coming this soon. But after Wednesday night's performance, I could understand why there were some people in the organization, particularly Red Bull New York head of sport, Kevin Thiewall, felt maybe it was the right time to make the change. But craziness as always.
Of course, yeah. I mean, I don't. The listeners probably don't want to hear us talk about process, but you're absolutely right that I remember back in the days when I was working on the news beat that there was nothing more sort of exhilarating than something that was breaking quickly as a reporter. But that aside, Michael, I guess the question, the big question is, was it the right move in your opinion? Was it time? Was it time to move in a different direction?
I thought maybe they might have pulled the trigger a little too early. I would have liked to have seen how the team responded under Armas against Philadelphia. You know, the team has struggled big time since coming back from the MLS is back tournament. They've had only two goals. One was a gift when Sean Johnson let a ball go through his hands and it turned into a goal and a 1-0 victory for the Red Bulls over NYCFC. Incredibly, the Red Bulls forwards haven't scored a goal in 9 matches this season. And I know part of it is the player's fault, but it's also some of the blame has to be put on the coaching staff as well, too, not using the right players or the right system to score goals. I think there's plenty of blame to go around with this organization, no doubt about it, from the front office, from even Austria, yes, Salzburg as well, too. I think this club has not gotten anywhere near its potential over the last few years. But I really, you know, with a 3-4-2 record, I thought maybe Armas would have been given at least another game or two. Maybe to see if he could turn things around. We don't know internally what was happening there, too, with personalities.
No, for sure. And look, I find this interesting in the sense that, Michael, like both of us have been around MLS circles for long enough to remember when that type of record wouldn't have been anywhere close to getting yourself fired in this league, that there wasn't as much pressure to win immediately. And with the Red Bulls, we've sort of wondered what the motivations were in Austria for this club, what the goals were, whether this is about development, whether this is being part of the overall system, or whether this is about winning now. This sort of indicates to me that there is at least some pressure on the win now front. What do you think this move says about the purpose of the Red Bulls, the goals that the Red Bulls Corporation has for this club?
I think it is right. It is right now to move. Win now. I think most teams in the world want to win now. Yes, there are ones that are rebuilding. You can make a case, a big case, saying that the Red Bulls are rebuilding after you know, they got jettisoned Bradley Wright Phillips, who had an injury-plagued poor season last year. Luis Robles was not the same goalkeeper as he was in the past in 2019, and they let him go as well, too. So they are rebuilding to a certain extent. The problem is the pieces that they're using to rebuild, and I keep going back to this one theme my entire career, it's the midfield. It's the midfield stupid. I'm not talking to you. I'm talking about in general. You know, if you don't have a dynamic midfield, you're not going to make an impact. And I don't think the Red Bulls have a dynamic midfield, except for Daniel Royer on the right side. The rest of the players, they're okay. I think their performances can go up and down. They're inconsistent. But compared to some of the midfields they had in the past, nowhere near it. And, you know, again, they're not bad players. They're just not impact players. Saying that, you know, they're not getting enough energy from their midfield to turn things to their side.
When we're looking at the Red Bulls, Michael, and we're looking at the past, we're looking at Jesse Marsh era was successful. At least it looked like the best Red Bulls, at least era, maybe not Metro Stars altogether, or maybe. And then you never want to be the one who replaces the one. And Chris Armas era will be forgettable, unfortunately, for the New York Red Bulls. Now moving on to the next era, a interim replacement will be named later, and there's also the assistant that departed the club also at the same time, CJ Brown, at the same time as Chris Armas. Now, with this new era is going to start, is there any chance someone in the organization that has done wonders with the Red Bulls 2 franchise as the manager for years and years, could he be the one to actually be ready finally to take over? And will John Wollin get his chance to manage the Red Bulls?
You know, it's funny, no matter who replaced Jesse Marsh, it would have been a tough act to follow because he did all the right things. Savvy coach. He deserves what he's getting over with Red Bull in Europe. No doubt about it. The success that he's had. Saying that, yes, let's look toward the future. The name I have kept hearing as a potential future Red Bull coach was John Molniak, a popular player. He might not have scored hundreds of goals for the team, but he scored some of the most memorable, most important goals in the club's history as a part-time starter, super sub, whatever you want to call it. That does not make a coach. He has been successful with Red Bull 2 over the last several years. The team, for a number of years, has made a big push on signing homegrown players. Some have been successful, some have not. But except for this season with Red Bull 2, Wolniak has enjoyed a big upside. Whether he's ready or not for the big time, I can't tell you that. Again, I don't know the background. I think he... From what I have seen, I have not been to any Red Bull 2 games in the last year or two. I've had plenty on my plate between the Red Bulls, NYCFC, and the Cosmos here going to games. But, you know, if the club thinks he's ready, you know, promote him to that top job. I can't make a prediction on what the team is going to do right now, but I think they have to make a move very quickly. It'd be interesting to see who's going to be running the show tomorrow night. Sunday night against Philadelphia.
Yeah, exactly. An interim, it says in the press release that we received that an interim manager will be named in the following days. So before the game this weekend, we'll for sure know who takes over in an interim basis and maybe for a longer-term basis. And again, we had John Wolinek on the show years and years and years ago, and he always been a manager that I've followed because I thought he showed a lot of promise as a manager for the future of soccer here in North America. Last question before we say goodbye for today, Michael. One big decision in the offseason that wasn't just Chris Armas, it was the entire organization in the front office to move away from Bradley Wright Phillips. And of course, when they decide this, now you have Bradley Wright Phillips lighting it up in LA, making the Red Bulls look bad. How important was that factor in the decision-making process, do you think? I know it's still early, but how important was that mistake by the Red Bulls in the equation of getting rid of this regime?
Oh, by the way, gentlemen, you're right on the ball, I think, because some of the topics you've are talking about and asking me about, I'm going to be answering in a column, so I guess I'll be previewing my column a bit. Bradley Wright Phillips is a complicated situation, and don't get me wrong, he filled the net for years with the team. I think he was the fastest player in MLS history to reach 100 goals. Humble guy, self-effacing humor. People loved him across the board. Obviously, when you get to a certain age as a striker, and he was, what, 33, 34 last year, he's injury plagued. His production is, what, 2 goals, 4 assists in 19 appearances, about half of them as a starter. You definitely get concerned, and he had a sizable salary too. The team probably says, hey, we can't pay him the same thing. He's going to have to take a big cut. And they say, you know, 34-year-old striker who's going to be 35 next year, not certain we could handle that. Hey, we have some promising players. Let's go ahead and try them there. But the thing is, a team picks him up, Los Angeles Football Club, and Bob Bradley, the coach of the team, has a great history of taking older players, veteran players, and reviving them. And he knows, you know, what buttons to push. And I know that sounds very easy, but he just knows how to get the most out of players. He did it with Eric Winalda years ago when he was with the Chicago Fire. And right now he's doing it with Bradley Wright Phillips. I think he understands you can't play Wright Phillips or start him every game. You don't want to run a 35-year-old striker into the ground. And he'll know when to start him, when to have him come off the bench, that sort of thing. I'm not certain, with all due respect to Chris Armas, I'm not certain, even if the Red Bulls had kept him, kept BWP, whether or not he had the experience and the wherewithal to understand how to handle a 35-year-old striker.
This league is so funny, Michael, because we're looking at, like, example, you have a project like Jesse Marsh had with the Red Bulls and Chris Armas, just continuation of that project. But in this league, you cannot be stubborn on the ideology of how you want your team to play. It's all about the people you have in front of you, regardless of what you thought was going to happen. And over the years, we've seen Gio Savarese react that way in Portland and just adjust a few things, even though it wasn't ideally what he wanted to do. The results dictated it. And LAFC and Bob Bradley has made an entire career, amazing career as a manager and a coach, to highlight the strength of its players and to hide its weaknesses. And we can hope for the best for the Red Bulls fans. They've been through a lot of last year and over the last 20 years also. Michael Lewis, always a pleasure to have you on the show. We hope you have a great rest of the day. We know it's going to be busy, and we can't wait until we read your article later today.
Well, hey, thank you very much for having me on, and it was great to share my opinions with you gentlemen, and hopefully for your sake there won't be much more breaking news today, particularly north of my border here.
Yeah, well, there will be one. I'm just waiting to see what it is for the impact later today. But on that note, thank you, Michael, once again. You can follow Michael on social media at Soccer Writer, and we'll be right back after this short break.
You are listening to Soccer Today. Follow us on Twitter at Soccer Today SPN and like our Facebook page, facebook.com/ Sports Podcasting Network. You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.
Winning season returns at MyBookie. Winning season means doubling your first deposit. Winning season means Survivor, Super Contest, and Squares. At MyBookie, winning season means hitting all your parlays and props with your feet up. watching your team trounce their rivals. Rejoice! It's time to celebrate the NFL season. Invest in your intuition, use promo code SBN, and double your first deposit. New players get up to $1,000 in free play, designed to add more excitement to the sports you love and the games you bet. From live betting to championship futures, every play you want to make is awaiting at MyBookie. It's simple. Make your picks, win big, collect your cash. Use promo code SPN and double your first deposit. Your winning season begins today, only at MyBookie. And we're back to continue a bit to talk about the Red Bulls. We'll look at the games this weekend also. But Duane, there's something to say about not getting stubborn in the way you want your team to play, adjusting to the reality of the team in front of you and getting the most out of it. According to Michael, this was closer to a firing. Well, according to their websites also, and they had to change this, but according to the Red Bull, this was closer to a sacking than a mutually parting ways, and I guess the Red Bull brass was not convinced that Chris Armas could lead this project and adapt the ideology of this team to get success.
Yeah, with the Red Bulls are a funny team because I do think there are some mixed motivations there, that they're part of a system, even more than NYCFC is, I believe. They're part of a system that wants to feed each other and ultimately act as a global selling market. So I think that his motivation is not just winning, which does play a role for sure, but also in developing talent. And if they ultimately, as an organization, didn't believe that he was meeting the winning side of things and didn't think that the development side of things was necessarily getting hit on either, then, yeah, this is a challenging moment. You mentioned the Red Bulls 2 coach as a possible replacement. That certainly is something to think about. I would also suggest that this was an opportunity that you might see someone from somewhere else in their system move. And they've showed it, right? Jesse Marsh. Moved up their system. So it's they share. And that's something to watch for here as well. The Red Bulls have become invisible in a lot of ways. They have always sort of suffered a little bit in MLS history in terms of being a forgotten team. They've, of course, famously never won the MLS Cup. They have won a couple Supporter Shield, including one under Armas. So that is something to celebrate if you're a fan. But you know, as we all know, this is not a league where the shield is the most important trophy. So they haven't won the big one. And that's you know, as a first dayer, that's something to not be too proud of. You know, them in Dallas and New England, of course, but New England's at least played in a few more finals. It's a infamous sort of thing to have of hanging over your franchise. And I'm not sure a lot of people in Red Bull land view this team as having a lot of direction beyond the simple development of Talbot. And, you know, I'll let you jump in after this. It's the Tyler Adams is a great developed story in that, but I don't know how inspired you are as a Red Bulls fan just by watching him excel somewhere else, right?
Yeah, he still has the Red Bull badge on it, but it's not the right city, so it does feel different. But you know, the Red Bull New York, the Chris Armas era, and now, you know, you can shake off the Jesse Marsh era, and looking at him in Europe now, you can shake it off. It's, you know, no one remembers David Moyes as manager of Manchester United, okay? And no offense to Chris Armas, was that? Did he have enough success to carve his own path in the Red Bull history? That's a question. I think longevity has something to do with it, and longevity is not part of the New York Red Bulls history, at least not with Chris Armas. And we'll see where they go down the line. I truly hope that they look in their backyard for John Wolanek, who deserves a chance. And I believe, like you mentioned, that they look at their managers just like players, and they want their managers to go up, to progress in their career. And it's about time that John Wolanek progresses, because he's done everything he could do in the USL with Red Bulls 2 for, what, 6 years now, I believe? I talked to him 5 years ago, so a long time ago. Let's look now, before we continue, we'll look at Major League Soccer, the games that are coming this weekend. But Duane, it's now it's a tradition. Let's talk about Messi. So we've talked to our sources once again. We've looked at the potential of Messi staying, Messi leaving. What do you have for us today in our daily Messi update?
Well, there's contrasting information on today's Messi mess. It's you have his father saying publicly that they believe it's their position that the clause, the release clause, is not relevant anymore. That he met the obligations of what he had to do to allow him to leave on the free. This, of course, we've talked about before, is this clause they had where if he informed the club at the end of the season that he wanted to move in any of the last few years, he could. This was controversial that it was even in the clause. It sort of speaks to the fact that Messi was already having some suspicions that he might want to trigger this a few years out when he added it to his contract. Of course, COVID-19 complicated things by pushing the end of the Champions League until what was it, last week? Week and a half ago now.
2 weeks ago, yeah.
So basically what's happening is Barcelona is being pedantic, legally pedantic, which is the only way lawyers like to be, is pedantic.
I was going to say, is there any other way? Can you be any other way as a lawyer or law? Anyways, go ahead.
Exactly. Which isn't a great look for Barcelona, but it might be a legally successful look, right? So that's what's happening here. Jorge has suggested, Mr. Messi, has suggested that this isn't what they believe to be true. You know, they have some lawyers, perhaps some lawyers that might be paid by, you know,
by Messi.
Wearing sky blue ties. I'm not sure.
Lawyers coming from England, from Manchester?
Yeah, perhaps. That might be played in here that might fight this. Now, the other side of this coin today, the contrasting part of this, Kevin, is there is reports in Argentina just this morning that were coming out, mostly in Argentina, that Messi is set to now announce that he will, in fact, be staying. Now, that's as much as we know. Staying can mean a lot of things. It can mean staying for a couple of weeks. It could mean staying, you know, re-signing a new deal, or it could be staying
in the Liga
on the free.
Okay, so cue the meme of Leonardo DiCaprio in The Wolf of Wall Street that I'm not effing leaving. So we might see Lionel Messi drop on our social media, I'm not effing leaving. Or maybe we're going to see, you thought I wasn't leaving, but I gone. I'm going. I'm taking the express flight to Manchester. We'll see what happens. At this point, I don't think there's any other possible scenario than Messi staying in Barcelona or Messi going to Manchester. It's one or the other, and either going to be happy about it. You know what? He's not going to be happy about it either way. You really think this guy wanted to leave Barcelona and he's basically having a bluff called, and no one's a winner in this situation. If you're a Barca fan, if you're Bartomeu, if you're Barcelona, if you're Messi, or if you're Man City and you have to pay $700 million, there's no winners in this.
Yeah, well, Messi's not going to pay $700 million. I mean, they have a lot of money, but they're not dumb. Especially when they know that they can just wait 4 months and not have to pay it. Like, that's just insanity, right? Like, and it's like Barcelona's acting like they have leverage in this when they really don't. Really, I think what their leverage is, and we saw Bartomeu get called out for corruption by Catalonian police the other day. Mm-hmm. This might be an effort to push him out early.
The police are soccer fans. Sorry.
Yeah. This is madness, right? Like, this is soap opera stuff. The police are getting involved to try and anyway.
The police is Catalan. Like, the Catalonia police will be like, you know what? We're a fan of this team. What can we do to help? Do we have any proof? Yeah. Any proof whatsoever? Oh, we have one corroborating witness testimony? Perfect. Let's indict him. Let's indict him and help the situation.
Yeah, who knows? I'm not going to get into that right now, but that was another development that happened, I guess it was yesterday. It's not pretty. I guess, look, if you're Barcelona, what you might think too, or if you're Messi camp, is you might think, okay, let's take a step back. They're going to pay me a lot of money, so I can go play and he can break the record too. He can break the world record for most goals for a single club. He probably will if he does stay for the first half of the season. And then if January rolls around and he really still feels the same way, then he can in fact sign a pre-contract with Manchester City. And at that point, if he does that, then Barcelona, it's in their best interest to just work out something to move him earlier rather than later. And they've tried, right? It's one way or another, I think he's probably going to leave now. And as you say, it probably is City. I mean, a lot can change in a year. You never know. But I think it probably is City at this point. Now, from a City perspective, honestly, if you're Manchester City, you have a pretty good team. And you have a team that, you know, didn't get as far in the Champions League as they should have. based on how it played out, but nonetheless still got, you know, compared to the rest of the world, pretty damn deep into that competition. So they're not like they're a non-factor already. They don't need him right now. They would like him. They don't need him. And they probably are thinking, like, we're going to move on at the end of this week. Not move on completely, but move on publicly and just move forward with the players we have to start this season. Because as from a City perspective, I think you just don't want that distraction hanging over you as you start. There's flaws to that team, as I said. And if you don't have your players are distracted, like if Jesus is sitting there going, like, do I need my passport? Like, are you sending me to Spain? Or like they might not perform. So I think from their perspective, they'd rather just have this wrapped up now. And if it's no, it's no. Because ultimately this fell into their lap, right? Like, I don't think anyone in Manchester City was thinking that Lionel Messi was a realistic target 7-8 months ago. No one was. And then suddenly here he is, and you're like, okay, well, yeah, it's, again, I do the dating analogy, like the, you know, the model that lives down the street starts to show fancy you. You're like, this was possible, but I'm going to take a run at this.
Yeah, of course. Of course. And you think your wife's going to let you go easily? No, they're going to sue you, and they're going to ask for a lot in the divorce, which is why Barcelona is trying to hold on to that clause.
Yes, exactly.
on that note, Duane has to go. So okay. we'll let Duane go, and we'll
continue. Bye, guys.
Bye, Duane. And on that note, we'll look at the schedule for Major League Soccer this weekend, which is going to be a busy weekend in Major League Soccer. Tomorrow, Houston Dynamo versus Sporting Kansas City, Orlando City versus Atlanta United, the Vancouver Whitecaps versus Toronto FC, and San Jose versus Colorado. That's Saturday, and we have Sunday's game, also Major League Soccer, New York Red Bulls versus Philly. We'll see who is the manager of the New York Red Bulls on Sunday. DC, NYCFC, Columbus, Cincinnati, another Battle of Ohio to look forward to on Sunday. Chicago, New England, Inter Miami, Nashville, the Battle of the Expansion Teams, Minnesota, RSL, Seattle, and Portland, Cascadia Battles Sunday evening. And Sunday's being capped off by another great El Tráfico between the LA Galaxy and LAFC during the weekend. So that's one thing. I talked to you earlier in the show in the potential news of the Montreal Impact. Well, we have news. I need to look into it more, but the Montreal Impact are changing the structure of their academy. They have a U23 team now who's going to have more structure in the academy of the club. So a U23 team is going to be managed by Jason DiTullio. And that is basically the top team of the academy. It takes over from the void of FC Montreal that was disbanded just about 3 years ago. And we're going to see more in the structure of the Academy of the Montreal Impact under Patrick Leduc, the new director of the Academy. And Patrice Bernier has a new role also. He'll be supervisor post-formation, so that includes a U23 team and U21 team, I believe, where he will have some responsibilities in looking all that with with the team, the U23 team of Jason DiTullio. So we'll have more on that later when we have more information. The new team, at least in the Development Academy side, will be playing in the new academy system of Major League Soccer. The new, what used to be the USSDA, has now been disbanded and taken over from USSF by Major League Soccer. And they will have an in-depth academy program with Major League Soccer team, USL team, and independent teams, academies, all academies together with this new structure. The Impact will be part of this structure. I'm still looking for more information on where this U23 team will play, what will be the ideology behind it, and I need to go deep into this, but we'll find more information on my Twitter at Kev Laramée. You can follow Duane also at 24th Minute and this show at Soccer Today SPN live Monday to Friday around 11 a.m. Eastern, 8 a.m. Pacific. You can find the podcast version anywhere. anywhere you find your favorite podcast. Thank you for everyone for listening to this show over the last few months. Our numbers are really growing, and we've been voted also the third best Major League Soccer podcast behind Extra Time Radio and behind The Call-Up by Major League Soccer 2. We're the number one independent podcast in soccer in North America, and that's because of you, the listeners, because you subscribe, because you download the shows, and that's why we've been voting at that place. So you can find that link also if you Google it. Thank you to everyone who helped make this happen. On that note, it's always a pleasure to talk to you about soccer. And until Monday, as always, have a great soccer.
You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.